Hello, and welcome to Opening Bars. When you think of the most popular Toto songs ever, you may think of I'll Be Over You, 99, or I'll Supply the Love, but most likely your top three will be Africa, Rosanna, and this one, Hold the Line. David Paich had this to say about writing it. It started out with the piano riff that is in the intro. I started playing this riff, and I just couldn't stop playing it. I played it for days, and I started singing, Hold the line, love isn't always on time. It was a phrase that just came into my head. It was a blessing. The words came to me in the night, and then I went to the verse. I wrote it in 2 hours. Sometimes songs come quickly like that. And sometimes I spend 2 years trying to finish the song. I really love listening to the live performances in particular. The fans go absolutely wild, singing joyfully along, Hold the line, love isn't always on time. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Let's get right to our analysis. We're using the treble and bass clefs here in this reduction, with three sharps, and no time signature right now. We begin in measure one with simple triads, F sharp minor in second inversion, then an A major in first inversion, to a full B minor 7. I know most sheet music omits the F sharp in this chord, but I'm pretty certain that I hear it. Then we move to E major, plus a neighboring tone A to create a little tension, which resolves back to that same second inversion E major. These bars are then repeated. The next four measures are very similar, but notice that the F sharp minor is now in first inversion, with the third of the chord on the bottom. I know, again, online sheet music has this notated identically to measure one, which matches what the brain expects to hear, but the direct repetition of measure one is an illusion and doesn't happen in the studio recording. Notice too that the bass line frames a D major where the B minor 7 once stood in the motif. So now we have echoes of that 6-7-1, the sliding backdoor progression we looked at in Lady Madonna by the Beatles. But here, already utilizing the natural minor scale degrees, and this time landing on the minor one. It's interesting when you listen to some live performances that the opening four bar riff is presented differently. Sometimes we hear full A major and D major triads in measure one, like this. Now, this is what you will likely encounter if you search online for sheet music for this piece. As you can see, there is a time signature of 12-8, one you may not encounter very often. Perhaps your first response might be, is this correct? Well, it is, and perhaps it isn't. Let's have a look. Most often you will see eighths in this time signature for popular music grouped in threes. However, the number 12 is evenly divisible by both 2 and 3, so beamed groupings of 2, 3, 4, and 6 are all possible. If we renotate this passage, we can get a clearer picture of how the harmonies move. Regardless, to perform this as written, you might expect that the eighths would all be evenly distributed throughout the measure, with a fairly unnoticeable division of pulse, especially if this piece were designed for a slower tempo. Or you might instinctively play each as they are beamed. But your other reaction might be, what exactly does 12-8 feel like anyway, and doesn't match what is heard on the Toto recording. Let's consider for a moment what band member Jeff Porcaro had to say about Hold the Line in a 1988 interview with Modern Drummer. "That was me trying to play like Sly Stone's original drummer, Greg Errico, who played drums on Hot Fun in the summertime. The hi-hat is doing triplets. The snare drum is playing 2 and 4 backbeats, and the bass drum is on 1 and the and of 2. That eighth note on the second beat is an eighth note triplet feel, pushed. When we did the tune, I said, gee, this is going to be a heavy 4-on-the-floor rocker, but we wanted a Sly groove. The triplet groove of the tune was David's writing. It was taking the Sly groove and meshing it with a harder rock caveman approach. So, I think it's clear that Jeff is thinking in triplets. Here are these opening bars then notated in 4-4 time. Messier? Perhaps. A better representation of the performance and feel? Maybe. Let's do an experiment here. Let's have the computer play both the 12-8 and 4-4 versions. Let's see if we can hear a difference. Here is the 12-8 first. And now, the 4-4 version, tempo corrected to match. Well, I don't think I hear a difference. But would a human performer make them sound different? That's an interesting question. So, even though the 8ths and 12 are grouped in 3s, I wouldn't feel compelled to create an articulated distinction in my playing. I'd still keep as even a rhythm and velocity as possible. Now, if we break this down to triplets in 4, would you play it to sound exactly like the 3/8 in 12/8? Or might you subtly change the emphasis on one or more of the trio? When David is playing, I hear him playing pretty straight, but when the band comes in, they're not. Take a look at the audio sample. The peaks are where the guitar slams in with those power chords. Let's have a listen. Notice where the sample is divided below. See how the second is slightly shortened, and the third comes in a little early, and is lightly elongated. Let's listen again so we can hear that. The triplets are not all the same throughout the piece either. Take a look at the descending minor 7 chords. They have differing values as well. So, our fundamental question is between notation and performance. Should this be written in 12-8, in conformity with our modern-day compulsion for a convenient notational strategy? Or should this be written in 4-4, with triplets, to more readily communicate a groove? Or let me throw in another wrinkle. If we consider the digital technological perfection that is achievable in modern productions, perhaps 12-8 is more applicable to most contemporary electronic releases. But if we want to represent feel achieved by analog artists, perhaps 4-4 with triplets is the better choice. What do you think? Leave a comment below. Now that you know the notes, you can concentrate on advancing specific piano techniques. One exercise we might construct is to play 12 triads in eighths and mix the groupings by placing accents in differing positions. Try groups of 2, 3, 4, or 6. Perhaps you might consider other custom arrangements. You can try the rhythmic pattern excerpted from this piano reduction of the Auger section in Stravinsky's The Rite of Spring. There are a lot of pieces in the pop idiom that might be notated in 12/8 time. Ones you might consider are Michael Jackson, The Way You Make Me Feel, Rihanna, Love on the Brain, Ed Sheeran, Perfect, Alicia Keys, Fallen, or Norwegian Wood by the Beatles. Have a listen. 12/8 or 4/4 with triplets. So, the original Moonlight Sonata by Beethoven was notated in cut common time with notated triplets. I wonder what it would look like in 12/8. Well, the first few bars would look like this. If a piano-playing alien came to Earth and saw this sheet music, never having heard a recording, would it, or could it, sound like the renditions we know and love today? I can't say for sure. Go ahead and play it using this score. Does it challenge your thinking about the music? Does it sound different to you? I hope you enjoyed your lesson today. Remember, don't just play notes. Make music. Until next time, thanks for listening.